determination of crude protein contents in a feed sample. This is practical number 14, and we are performing proximate feed analysis. Before we did dry matter determination, then we did ether extraction, and from the fat-free sample, we determined the crude fiber and ash content of a feed sample. The only thing which is left now, that is the crude protein content of a feed sample. Crude protein determination, or the technique which we use for this determination, basically it determines the nitrogen content of a feed sample. We are not going to determine the actual protein content of a sample. The reason being the technique which we use actually determines the nitrogen content of a feed sample. And on the basis of those nitrogen content, we calculate the crude protein content in a feed sample. So that calculation is basically on an assumption. That assumption is based on the average nitrogen content present in a feedstuff. So if we talk about the average nitrogen content, roughly protein contains 16% nitrogen. So that's why when we are using this technique, we are not able to differentiate about the form of nitrogen. So this nitrogen may come from the amino acids, or it may come from the urea, nitrates, or other NPN compounds. So this technique only tells us about the nitrogen content, and we are not aware of the nitrogen source. So in proximate analysis scheme, the estimation of protein is based on total nitrogen content of the feedstuff. And we assume that all nitrogen is in the form of protein. However, it may not be true for all feedstuff, because there are many feedstuffs which contain a considerable amount of nitrogen in the form of NPN compound. So that's why this is known as crude protein. Now, because the nitrogen, it may come from either the amino acids, or it may come from the NPN substances like urea, ammonia, uric acid, free amino acids, and amines. All are the NPN compounds. These NPN compounds, we are very well aware that they have a little nutritive value in case of monogastric species. So in case of ruminant animals, they are able to utilize these NPN compound, and they are able to convert these NPN compound or nitrogen from NPN compound into microbial protein. So NPN have worth in ruminant animals, but not in case of monogastric species. So the calculation of crude protein is based on the assumption that there is 16% nitrogen in the protein. If you remember the protein classification chapter, on an average protein contain 16% nitrogen. But this is not true for all type of feedstuffs, because the nitrogen content of many protein sources, they may be either less or more than 16%. Here are the examples of different feedstuff, like protein of aisle seeds contain 18.5% protein, whereas cereal contains 17.2% and plant leaf contain 15%. And animal protein sources contain 16%, and whereas the dairy product contain 15.7% nitrogen. So after determining the total nitrogen content, it is generally multiplied with a constant factor 6.25. So this is based on the assumption of 16% nitrogen in a protein. So 16% here means out of 100, there is 16 gram of protein. So 600 divided by 16 is equal to 6.25. So these are the two techniques which can be used for the determination of total nitrogen content of a feedstuff. One is known as gel digestion and distillation procedure. Geldal was a scientist, and the technique is based on this Geldol digestion and distillation procedure. And the second one is the calimetic method. So we are not using this calimetic method. We will use this Geldol process for the determination of nitrogen content of a feedstuff. Now, in the laboratory, we have this Geldol digestion and distillation operators. This is also shown in the picture. This is the Geldol digester, which is used to digest the feedstuff. And after digestion, we perform the next step, that is distillation procedure. We will use this apparatus for the distillation process. Though here in the picture, it's an automated, complete automated unit, but in our lab, we have a semi-automated unit where we do the distillation, but the last procedure or the last step is titration in nitrogen determination. So that titration will be done by manual way rather than this automated system is not present in our lab. So we have a DK20 digestion unit along with the VELP UDK system, and that is a semi-automated unit we have in lab for nitrogen determination. The principle of this Geldol digestion and distillation procedure is the sample containing protein is digested by heating with concentrated sulfuric acid in the presence of catalyst. So what happened during this process, all the organic material get digested and this catalyst help in this process. So it convert all nitrogen present in a feed sample into ammonium sulfate. In a next step, the sample solution containing ammonium sulfate is distilled in Geldol apparatus. Here we use strong alkali, we use sodium hydroxide for this distillation process. So what happened during this process, the nitrogen that is present in the form of ammonium sulfate is converted into ammonia gas. So this ammonia gas is then captured in a dilute boric acid solution. And then we perform the titration by using N-butane sulfuric acid, and the volume from the volume of the acid used during the titration process is used to calculate the amount of nitrogen content in a feedstuff. This nitrogen is then calculated and converted to crude protein by multiplying with a standard conversion factor. That standard conversion factor is 6.25. But if you are well aware of the type of sample, then you can use a particular conversion factor. But if you are unaware or the sample is unknown, then better to go for 6.25 factor. Apparatus and equipment are required, or glassware required for this experiment is, we need Geldol digestion apparatus and Geldol digestion flask, Geldol distillation apparatus, and we need volumetric flask, burette and pipettes for this experiment. In animal nutrition laboratory, we have a VELP Geldol digestion as well as distillation apparatus. We can run 20 samples at a time for the digestion, and a single sample can be run for distillation process. And distillation is also automated. Simply, you have to put the flask over there or the digestion flask over there, and you will get the ammonia in the boric acid solution. Then you will go for titration. In some feed mills, they have some traditional micro Geldol digestion and distillation apparatus, so where only one sample can be run at a time. So their digestion is separate, and that is a glass apparatus that can be that is available in different small feed mills or units. And those people usually rely on that glass apparatus because it's a cheaper and also give a very accurate result. But in a modern feed mills, which have a very good or well-established lab, they're using the LIQO analyzer or near infrared reflectance spectroscopy for the determination of feed components or nutrient composition of the feedstuffs. The following reagents are required for the determination of nitrogen. Number one, we need concentrated sulfuric acid that is required during the digestion process. Then there is a requirement for sulfuric acid that will be used during the titration process. N by 10 sulfuric acid is required. 40% sodium hydroxide solution is required for distillation purpose. Catalyst mixture is also required. So there are two type or composition of this catalyst mixture: potassium sulfate, copper sulfate, and iron sulfate as 110:1 ratio. And the second is potassium sulfate, mercuric sulfate as 110 ratio. You can prepare according to the available chemicals. And even these catalyst tablets, they are also available in the market. These well companies also providing or producing those catalyst tablets. So those tablets can be used as a catalyst mixture. Then we need a boric acid solution for capturing the ammonia gas. That's a 2% boric acid solution. So it can be prepared by dissolving 2 gram boric acid in 100 ml distilled water. And then for the titration purpose, we need methyl red as an indicator. So it can be prepared by having a 0.2% methyl red in 95% ethanol. These are the major steps which we will follow during the determination of nitrogen content in a feed sample. The one or the first step is digestion. Second one is dilution. Third one is distillation, then titration, and final, we will perform or we will do the calculations. The first step is digestion. So during this process, the sample nitrogen is converted to ammonium sulfate. So accurately weigh to the precision of 1 milligram, 1 to 2 gram of dried sample and transfer it to the Geldal digestion flask. So in Bell apparatus, we have Geldal digestion tubes. Then add 5 to 10 gram of catalyst mixture, or you can add simply one catalyst tablet, and then add 25 to 30 ml of concentrated sulfuric acid. You can put all the samples in the same way in different tubes. And at the same time, there is also a requirement. You have to run a blank sample. So in another digestion flask, digest only the same quantity of acid and catalyst mixture, which shall serve as a blank. So that if there is any nitrogen in the blank sample, so just to get your accurate value, this blank sample will help you if there is something or some nitrogen is present in the catalyst mixture or acid. So what are the functions of this catalyst mixture? The potassium sulfate in the digestion or catalyst mixture, it raises the boiling point of the acid, whereas the copper sulfate, it serves as a catalyst to speed up the reaction. Iron sulfate helps in avoiding any bumping if present, like due to some organic material, if some bumping might be there, so it will help to avoid that. Then place the flask on digestion apparatus, turn the heat on, let the sample digest till frothing cease. So in case of this valve system or automated digester, there is no need to go for turning the flask or turning the tube or removing the content, because 20 samples they are running at a time, and the tube do not need any sort of turning. But if you are doing this manual digestion and you are using the digestion flask, then there is a need to go for little turning of the flask so that the content remain come in contact with the sulfuric acid. So when all the carbon gets oxidized and the solution becomes clear, then remove the flask from digestion apparatus, turn the apparatus off, and let the content and flask cool. So in case of automated system, we have programming. So that system run according to the program, and we have made different program according to the type of feedstuff or the sample to be analyzed. So the system turn off automatically, and when it cools down, then we remove the digestion tubes from that apparatus. But in a manual system, when the solution become clear and it remain 1 to 2 ml, then you have to perform these functions, turn off the heat and let the content cool down. So at this point, you must be careful. Either you are running a manual system or you are running a valve automatic system, that the solution should not get dry. It means all the material should not get dry. So at least 1 to 2 ml of that digested solution should be there. Number one. Number two, the end point of a digestion is a clear solution. But when you are adding copper sulfate or iron sulfate, you might get little green or little bluish liquid in the flask. But you must be very much careful at that stage. That color do not affect the digestion process. But if there is a black color, so that indicates incomplete or partial digestion of the sample. It should be clear one. There should not be any black thing. Though if it's a green or little green or little light bluish color, so it is acceptable. But it should be a clear solution. There should not be anything in that solution. What happened during this process, feed nitrogen that reacted with sulfuric acid and digestion mixture, it is converted into ammonium sulfate. There is also production of sulfur dioxide, carbon dioxide, and water. So these gases, they are carcinogenic. So you should not inhale these gases. In valve system, there is a scrubber that do not allow these gases to get escaped. So those are scrubbed, and then there is a water circulating system that get the air purified. So that system is, you can say, environment eco-friendly. But if we are using the manual system, then these gases, they are, you can say, expired, or they are exhausted into the air. The second step is dilution. So that depend upon the protocol you are following. The protocol which we are following, we do this step. But in some cases or some labs, they do not go for the dilution. They directly run the tube and put into the distillation apparatus. We usually go for dilution of the sample, and we dilute it up to a level of 250 ml. The reason being, that will reduce the chemical usage during the distillation process. But if the nitrogen contents are very low, then we should go for distillation without dilution. So if you are performing the dilution, then go for making a volume of 250 ml or 100 ml. That depends upon your way of calculation. Accordingly, you have to fit the formula according to the dilution volume. So you should thoroughly wash the digestion flask with the distilled water, and then convert, transfer the content into a volumetric flask. Do again and again washing of the digestion flask, and transfer all the contents into a volumetric flask, and finally make the volume of 250 ml. So what happened during this process? Only the concentrated ammonium sulfate is converted into diluted ammonium sulfate. This is the third step, that distillation. During this step, the ammonium sulfate is reacted with the strong alkali for the release of nitrogen in the form of ammonia. That ammonia is then dissolved in a weak acid, that's a boric acid solution. So for this step, take 10 ml from that diluted solution. Take 10 ml of 2%, take 10 ml of 2% boric acid solution in a 100 ml beaker or flask. Then add one drop of indicator in it and set it under the condenser portion of the distillation apparatus. If you look at this picture in the well, this is a, though this is an automated system, but under our semi-automated system, we put beaker that contain this boric acid solution over here for the collection of the ammonia. So, carefully add 10 ml of the sample solution, that is from the diluted 250 ml solution. So take 10 ml of solution, in the digestion tube and then place that digestion tube under the distillation apparatus. But if you are using the micro gel dial apparatus, then take 10 ml of the sample solution and then add 10 ml of 40% sodium hydroxide solution to that gel dial distillation apparatus. Then place the stopper and turn the heat on by heating the water in attached round bottom flask. So this procedure you can follow for that glass gel dial distillation apparatus. But in case of our nutrition laboratory, you don't need these things. You have to simply take 10 ml of the sample solution in the digestion flask and place that digestion flask under the distillation apparatus. And the rest of the things, they will be automatically added. So if you look at this, this is the distillation apparatus. And here you have to place that digestion tube with 10 ml of the sample taken from 250 ml diluted sample. So you take 10 ml over here along with the tube, and then just you have to run the program from here. So there is no need for all these steps because this 40% sodium hydroxide solution and the distilled water is available, they are connected with the distillation apparatus through the program which we have entered in the distillation apparatus. It will automatically collect the required amount of NaOH and distilled water. We have adjusted that program with 10 ml of sodium hydroxide and 10 ml of distilled water. So when that apparatus, we are using this well apparatus, so it will automatically stop or it will automatically shut off when all that distillation process have been completed. But again, because we have adjusted all those program according to the feed sample, so if you are running some type of different samples, then you can adjust or you can enter your new program. The end point in this distillation apparatus is the capturing of this ammonia gas in boric acid solution. So how you come across this end point? At the start of that running or distillation time, the boric acid color due to methyl red indicator is either be light red color or it might be of a light orange color. So when the gas ammonia gas is captured by this boric acid solution, it turn into colorless. So it become colorless. That is the end point. So that will indicate the capturing of the ammonia gas. But again, when it turn into a colorless liquid or colorless fluid, then you have to count for at least 1 or 2 minutes. So we have set the apparatus according to this. At the start, the methyl red color is either light orange or bright red. And when there is a production of gas, it color turned into, you can say a light color, and then it turn into a, it become colorless. So that is the end point. And then the apparatus will run for at least 1.5 minutes more so that all the gas will be captured by that boric acid solution. So what happened during this process, the ammonium sulfate is reacted with the alkali solution and we get ammonium hydroxide and sodium sulfate. So this ammonium hydroxide, due to the distilled water, there's a steam production, it is converted into ammonia and water, and that is captured in boric acid solution. The last step is the titration. We take that beaker that contains this boric acid solution and ammonia that beaker that contains boric acid solution, and the captured ammonia is present in that boric acid solution, and we titrate it against N by 10 sulfuric acid solution till the appearance of a light pink color. So it is light pink color or might be light orange color, and this is the end point. So when this light pink color appears, you will have to note down the volume of acid used during the titration process. So before starting the titration process, note down the volume of the acid, and when this titration has been completed, then again note down the reading, so that in this way you can get the volume of the standard acid solution used during the titration process. And similarly, you have to go for the blank sample, so that if there is any nitrogen, that can be calculated. You can use this formula for the calculation. Volume of acid used in the titration is equal to volume used for sample minus volume used for blank. If there is any difference, then you can get an accurate calculation for the nitrogen. So you can do calculation by this way. You need the volume of acid used in the titration. Like if you are running the blank sample and there is a use of acid, so it clearly indicates the presence of nitrogen in the blank sample. So in that case, you have to go for taking both readings, and volume of acid used for sample minus volume of acid used during the blank. So this difference will give you the actual volume of acid used during the titration process. Now put this value in the formula. Percent nitrogen in the sample is acid used in the titration, then 0.0014. This is the factor. I will let you know from where this factor comes out. Next is volume of sample solution. So this is the volume of sample solution, that is 250. This figure remains same if you are following this protocol, because we are diluting the sample up to 250 ml. Next is volume of diluted solution used for distillation. This will again same for all the samples, that would be 10 ml, because we are using 10 ml of out of this 250 ml for the titration purpose. And weight of sample, that has been recorded at the start of the experiment. And when you get the value of percent nitrogen in the sample, simply multiply it with 6.25 to get the value of crude protein. So these are the factors. If the sample is known to you, then you can use these factors for the calculation of protein. Like for corn, the factor is 6.25. For rice, it is 5.95. And then for peanut, 5.46. But if you are not aware of the sample, then better to use the average value, that is 6.25. So this factor is specific for N/10 acid. It is derived from ammonia. The normal solution of ammonia contains 14 gram of nitrogen per liter of its solution, or 0.014 gram per ml. Since the acid used in titration, it is 0.1 normal. So you can get the equivalent 0.014 into 0.1, it becomes 0.0014. So if you are using an acid whose normality is different, like we are using an acid with a normality of 0.2 or N/20, then simply you have to multiply it with 0.014 into N/20 of 0.05, you will get a value of 0.0007. So in that case, your factor for calculation will be 0.0007. But if you are using N/10, then the factor will be 0.0014. Here the 14 gram is the nitrogen per liter, it becomes 0.014 per ml, and we are using 0.1 N. So when you multiply it, you get a value of 0.0014. So in case of N/20, 1/20 means 0.05, you will then you have to use this factor 0.0007. So here is an example for your calculation. You can use this example for getting an idea. Like here we have a feed sample, weight 1.01 gram. We use 5 gram digestion mixture, and the 0.1 N sulfuric acid used for titration purpose is 0.9 ml. So this is the volume of acid used during titration. Volume of diluted solution taken for distillation, 10 ml, same for in every case. And the total volume of the solution which we made, that is 250 ml. So if you put these value in the formula over here, then you will get a nitrogen value of 3.11. So the percent nitrogen in this sample is 3.11. Or if you multiply it with 6.25, you will get a value of 19.49. So this is the amount of CP prelate in the feed sample. This is all about crude protein determination, but I just want to show you one more thing. That is a latest technique which is available, and we can use this for the determination of nitrogen. This is known as LECO nitrogen analyzer. So in a LECO nitrogen analyzer, nitrogen is converted to nitrous oxide compound. So that is analyzed by a detector and it measures the nitrogen content. Calculations and assumptions, they are same as for the Geldar. So you can say this is a very eco-friendly type of apparatus that can be used for the determination of total nitrogen content of a sample. Here you need only half gram of sample, and you can say in a very small quantity of sample. So it's a non-destructive technique. We don't need any chemical like sulfuric acid or sodium hydroxide or water. So we can get the sample analyzed within a very short time. Similarly, near infrared reflectance spectroscopy can also be used, though these apparatus, they are very costly and their initial cost is very high. So that's why they are usually not used in small scale laboratories, but for commercial point of view or where large number of samples are to be analyzed, these are the good choices.